Is now being recorded.
Welcome to the AMDA webinar, the contribution of the IPA survey to our understanding of the natural course of Pompe disease and the effects of enzyme therapy, 10 years of the IPA survey. Your speaker for today's program is Dr. Chris von der Meiden, a research physician with the Department of Pediatrics at the Center for Lysosomal and Metabolic Diseases. Operator assistance is available at any time during this conference by pressing #0. A question and answer session will follow the presentation. You may send chat questions at any time during the presentation using the chat window located to the right lower left of the presentation screen. I will now turn the call over to Dr. von der Meiden. Please begin.
Thank you for the introduction. A good day, everyone. My name is Chris van der Meijden, and welcome to the webinar on the IPA Erasmus MC Pump Survey. After the webinar, you have indeed reserved some time for a Q&A session, so please hold your questions until then. First, let me introduce myself. On this slide, you see my picture and a short resume. Late 2011, I finished med school. Thereafter, I worked as a pediatric resident at a regional hospital. Last March, I've started as a research physician at the group of Professor Van der Ploeg at the Center for Lysosomal and Metabolic Diseases. Well, there it was my slide. At the Center for Lysosomal and Metabolic Diseases at the Erasmus MC in Rotterdam. That was the picture you just saw on the other slide. The major topics of my PhD are the effects of ERT in juvenile pump patients and the results of the data of the patients participating in the IPA survey. I'd like to start this webinar with a brief overview of the pathophysiology of Pompe disease. Glycogen, you can see here, is the storage form of glucose, which is normally degraded in the lysosomes. Seems like my slides are moving. As I was saying, glycogen is a storage form of glucose that's degraded in the lysosomes by the enzyme acid alpha-glucosidase. In Pompe disease, a deficiency of this enzyme leads to glycogen accumulation in the lysosome. This accumulation leads to cell damage, which is most outspoken in muscles of the proximal extremities and those involved in respiration, like the diaphragm. Pompe disease has a broad clinical spectrum. At one side of the spectrum lies the classic infantile form. These patients have no alpha-glucosidase activity. They suffer from severe hypotonia and have hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. In treatment, these patients usually die within the first year of life. At this two pictures, you can see examples of patients with classic infantile Pompe disease. On the other side of the spectrum, you have the adult patients who have residual activity. These patients get usually diagnosed during their child or adulthood and have slower progression of their disease. Proximal muscle weakness and respiratory problems are characteristic for this group. The Erasmus MC has been involved in Pompe research since 1984. During the last 30 years, we have been involved in the cloning of the GEA gene. We created a knockout mouse model and demonstrated the efficacy of ERT in this model. Furthermore, we treated the first patient with ERT. This, in combination with the work of many other research groups, has ultimately led to the registration of ERT with the FDA and the EMA. In 2002, as this big arrow shows, the IPA Erasmus MC Pompe survey started. In the next few slides, I'll discuss why we started the survey, what its goals are, and why we ask the questions that we ask. On this slide, you can see the two different versions we have of the survey. Currently, we have a web-based and a paper version. POMP survey started in 2002 as an initiative of the International POMP Association and the Erasmus MC, with the goal to create more insight on POMP disease in adult patients. At the moment the survey started, POMP disease in adults wasn't adequately described in the literature yet. With ERT around the corner, it was important to learn more about POMP disease in adults, since we needed to define good outcome measures to evaluate the effect of this new therapy once it became available. Since POMP disease is a rare disease, the survey was at that moment the most practical tool to reach a vast number of patients. And that way we could learn how POMP disease impacted their lives. Now let's see if it doesn't skip ahead. Okay. The initial goals of the survey were to gather information on the natural course of POMP disease in adults and assess the severity of the disease in these patients. Another goal of the survey was to measure how disease impacted the daily lives of these patients and their well-being through specific questionnaires that addressed those issues. We felt this was important because it gives the patients perspective on clinical outcome measures like can you walk or not. A secondary goal after ERT got approved in 2006 was to monitor and evaluate the effect of ERT by comparing the data of the patients on ERT with the data gathered in the previous years. In this figure, you can see how the POMP survey is organized. We started in 2002 and continuously followed and included patients since then. The Dutch patients are included through our outpatient clinic, and all the other patients are included through the hard work of all the POMP representatives around the world. The questionnaire itself consists of 14 topics on subjects ranging from diagnosis to family history to the use of healthcare. We designed the survey so it would cover several aspects of the life of the patients. The topics were selected based on a literature review of 225 cases, the expert opinions of leaders in the field, and the experience of patients themselves. Furthermore, we added additional questionnaires to the survey. The fatigue severity scale was added because fatigue was a frequently reported problem at the outpatient clinic. However, it was very underreported in the literature at that time, so that kind of grasped our interest. The Rotterdam Handicap Scale is a scale that measured participation, which is defined as the nature and extent of a person's involvement in life situations. Restriction in daily life activities is one of the most important things patients notice about their disease and has a substantial impact on their well-being. Finally, we added the SF36, which stands for short form 36 health survey. This survey measures quality of life on the physical and mental domains and is used in many different diseases. Health-related quality is very valuable in assessing the impact of the disease on daily life.
Excuse me, Chris, could you please speak a little louder? Thank you.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm also sorry for the slides so that seem skipping. I think I built in some timings accidentally, but I don't know how it comes that it skips ahead. At this moment, we have 408 people participating in the POMP survey. Most participants originate from the Netherlands, and the United States. At this moment, we also have participants from the United Kingdom, Australia, France, Canada, Germany, and several other countries, like Belgium or Brazil. Half of the participants are male. The median age of the participants when they join the survey is 47 years. And they range from actually 2 years to 81 years. 34 of the participants use a wheelchair when they are included, and 41 use respiratory support. Since the survey started, 265 patients have started with ERT. For each patient, we have a median follow-up of 5 years to a maximum of 11 years, which is really, really much. Since 2002, the survey has provided us with a wealth of information on adult competencies. At this moment, 16 articles have been written and published with the help of the survey. In the following section, I'm going to discuss the main findings of these articles. The first results were published on the natural course by Marloes Hagemans. After that, her successor, Dennis Gunger, focused on describing the effects of ERT. The first study described the clinical manifestation of Pompe disease in 54 Dutch patients. This study showed that adult Pompe disease is a progressive disease where events take place at consecutive moments in the life of the patient. Recently, we repeated parts of the study for all the 408 patients that we currently have included, and we found striking resemblance with the original results. This figure shows the distribution of age of the participants when they undergo certain events in life. On the y-axis, you can see the different events that occur through the life of the patient, like the moment they get their first complaints, when they get diagnosed, when people have walking problems, when they start artificial ventilation or a wheelchair, and when they start ERT. On the x-axis, you see the age and years at which these events can occur. The gray bar indicates the 10th to the 90th percentile of this age, and the black bar in the middle is the median age at which these events occur. The n is the number of patients that were available for evaluation. And as you can see, most of the patients have their first symptoms around the age of 30, however 90% actually has symptoms before the age of 12 years. Patients get usually diagnosed in their mid-30s, have problems rising from lying at the age of 40, started using a wheelchair or ventilation in their early 40s, and finally start ERT in their late 40s. An important finding from the first studies performed with the Pompe survey was that the disease severity of adult Pompe patients mainly increases with disease duration, but not with age. This figure describes the percentage of patients displayed on the y-axis that uses a wheelchair or respirator support. Patients are divided by age groups, and the white bar the white bar represents the percentage of patients in a wheelchair, and the gray bar represents the number of patients on respiratory support. And the N is again the number of patients available for analysis in each group. If you look at this figure, you can see there isn't much difference between the age groups. However, if you look at the second figure, we again have displayed the number, the percentile of patients or in a wheelchair or on a respirator. And this time we met disease severity on the y-axis. You can see that the longer a patient is diagnosed with disease, the more chance he has to be in a wheelchair or on a ventilator. There we are. The fatigue severity scale was added, as I stated before, to assess fatigue. Fatigue was reported very much by our patients in the outpatient clinic, but only reported in the literature. The fatigue severity scale, the FSS, is a 9-item questionnaire that's specifically designed to assess fatigue. The answers range from strongly disagree, which merits 1 point, to strongly agree, which merits 7 points. The median of the 9 items represents the level of fatigue, and higher mean scores indicate a higher level of fatigue. When we assessed fatigue in the international population, it turned out to be much of a bigger problem than previously anticipated. 9 out of 10 patients was fatigued. And out of these 9 out of 10 patients, 2/3 were severely fatigued. Furthermore, 2/3 of the patients classified fatigue as one of their most disabling symptoms. Fatigue was also most outspoken in the most severely affected patients, which you can see in this figure. On the y-axis again, you see the fatigue severity scale scores, and on the x-axis you see the different groups of the disease severity. The black box is the mean score for each group. I'm very sorry for the slide. And the bar indicates the confidence interval. You can see that patients without a wheelchair or without ventilation have relatively low FSS scores. However, compared to the healthy controls, fatigue is way, way, way higher in the pump patients. Here we see the effect of ERT on fatigue. It's kind of a complicated figure. On the y-axis we see again the fatigue severity scale scores, and on the x-axis we see the time. This part of the time is of the untreated patients before they start ERT, and here we see the follow-up after the dotted line of the follow-up time on ERT. Each circle represents an individual measurement, which means this is one questionnaire filled out by one patient at a given point in time. The black bar is represents the mean change of fatigue before the start of ERT and after the ERT. This is called the broken stick method for repeated measurements. And it indicated that after the start of ERT, patients became significantly less fatigued. All right, quality of life was assessed with the short form 36 health survey. This is a generic questionnaire divided in 8 domains that covers physical and mental components of quality of life. Examples of the physical components are general health, fatality, and bodily pain. Examples for the mental component are emotional role functioning, social functioning, and mental health. The SF36 is used in many different patient populations and has been translated in more than 40 languages. Pump survey was the first to describe quality of life in untreated adult patients. We found that quality of life is reduced in these patients compared to the general population. The physical domain was most affected, while the mental domain and bodily pain remained relatively spared. On this figure, you can see how the pump patients scored on the 8 domains compared to the general population. Each line of the star represents a subdomain. The dotted line is the average score for the healthy controls, and the solid line is the average score for the adult pump patients. How closer the line is to the edges of the star, how better the score. You can see that mental health, role function, emotional and bodily pain remain unaffected. physical functioning, role function, role function of physical, and general health are most affected. Furthermore, it was demonstrated that patients were more impaired at lower quality of life than patients. Furthermore, it was demonstrated that patients were more impaired at lower quality of life and patients with longer disease duration had higher mental health and role function physical scores. This latter phenomena was attributed to the ability of patients to adapt and cope with their physical situation over time. There we go. We also assessed the effect of ERT on quality of life. We found that before ERT, there was a significant decline in quality of life on the physical component. During the first 2 years of treatment, a positive trend was demonstrated. However, after the first year of treatment, the physical component scores stabilized. The halt of decline is can be interpreted as a positive outcome. Mental health scores didn't change over time because they were already normal. Participation was measured through the Rotterdam Handicap Scale. This scale gives information on a person's ability to perform tasks and activities in everyday situations. Therefore, the scale gives information on a subject that's very important to patients. The scale is divided in domains covering work, study, traveling, kitchen tasks, and how well a person is able to move around, perform tasks, and leisure activities in and outdoors. The total score ranges from 9 to 36, and higher scores represent higher participation. There we go. Well, this slide is probably going to give a whole lot of moving around. So let's see if you can control it. When assessing participation in adult patients, we found reduced Rotterdam handicap scales compared to the general population. As you can see in this bar chart, pump patients scored in general 26 points and healthy controls scored the maximum of 36 points. When looking at the individual domains, we saw that outdoor activities, and work and study were most affected. Here you can see them. This is outdoor activities, and this is work and study. 31 of the patients weren't able to perform outdoor activities, and 40% of the patients were unable to perform the job or study. Furthermore, more severe affected patients and older patients have lower participation. There it is. This trend is also present in quality of life fatigue. This figure shows mean Rotterdam handicap scales on the y-axis and the patient groups. So the least impaired, the ones with the wheelchair, the ones with the ventilator, and the ones with the wheelchair and ventilator on the x-axis. Black boxes represent again mean scores, and the bars the confidence interval. We can see that patients without a wheelchair or ventilator have the best Rotterdam handicap scales, Rotterdam handicap scales scores, followed with patients who are only respirator dependent. The effect of ERT on participation is displayed in this figure. It's another broken stick analysis. On the y-axis we see again the Rotterdam handicap scale scores, and on the x-axis the years of follow-up. This is pre-ERT again, and this is the follow-up after ERT. Here was ERT started. Each dot is an individual questionnaire that's filled out at any given moment in time, and the lines show the trend. So pre-ERT there was a significant decline, and after ERT there was a stabilization. This is very positive, since it means patients are able to maintain their level of functioning rather than lose the ability to participate in social situations. The studies on survival were one of the most interesting results derived from the POMP survey. In babies with classic infantile POMP disease, the positive effect of survival was established during the first trials. However, in adult POMP patients, it's much harder to demonstrate a positive effect on survival, since adults don't have the severe course of disease that infants do. In order to try to demonstrate an effect of ERT on survival, we first needed to evaluate if survival was reduced in untreated patients by comparing death rates with the general population. After that, we could calculate the difference between treated and untreated patients. These studies have proven to be of great influence on the reimbursement discussion in several countries. When we compared the Dutch subgroup of patients with the general population, we found that untreated patients have an elevated risk to die, as illustrated in this figure. Furthermore, when assessing survival in untreated adult patients, we found that how more severely patients are affected, the bigger the risk is to die. This slide shows the effect of ERT on survival. We used several time-dependent Cox proportional hazard models, which are statistical models, to assess survival. We compared treated with untreated patients and found that ERT has patients are on ERT have at any given moment during their follow-up a 59% smaller chance to die than patients who are not on ERT. This figure is simplified survival curve to illustrate the difference. The POMP survey was also used for several different side projects. The data provided by the survey was used in an article to highlight the beneficial effects of newborn screening by describing the health status of adult patients at diagnosis. Furthermore, the data was used to calculate the burden of the burden of disease, and was used for starting points for new questionnaires like the RPECT. Most importantly, the infrastructure supported by the patient organizations enabled us to reach the vast number of patients, which were also contacted for other projects. For example, a few years ago, the Dutch and German patients participated in a study to assess pain in POMP patients. Over the last 12 years, the POMP survey has given us a wealth of information. It enabled us to describe the natural course of disease and the positive effects of ERT. Furthermore, the articles on survival have proven to be of great influence for patients around the world. The reason why the survey has become so successful is the collaboration directly with the patients' organizations. In 2002, international collaboration between physicians wasn't that well developed as it is now, and patients were scattered over different countries and different physicians. Therefore, it was hard to reach a great number of patients and provide robust results. However, the patient organizations already existed and were in contact with patients on a national level. By collaborating with these organizations, we were able to make the largest database with the most consistent follow-up regarding patient-reported outcomes. It has enabled us to describe the natural course and provide solid results on fatigue, quality of life, participation, and even robust endpoints like survival. We are also extremely happy with the timely start of the survey. Oh, sorry, no. It didn't skip. As I was saying, we were also extremely happy with the timely start of the survey before ERT became generally available. once more and more patients start treatment, and it becomes harder to get data on the natural course, as I've illustrated in this figure. Before 2006, almost no patients were on ERT, while most patients are on ERT. If the survey was started now, it would be very hard to describe the natural course of disease, almost impossible to assess the effects of ERT. Finally, we conclude that after more than 10 years working with survey, patient-reported outcomes have proven to be quite valuable. They enabled us to measure functioning in a social context and added in that way the patient's perspective to clinical outcome measures like can you walk, how many hours of respiration do you have, how far do you walk. Furthermore, these outcomes measures are deemed increasingly important by organizations like the FDA and the EMA and ultimately contribute to the registration and reimbursement of ERT. After more than 10 years, we can look back at the period where much has been accomplished. However, it's also good to look at the future, set goals, and make plans. Our continuous goal is to reach more and more patients with Pompe disease and keep them engaged. Recently, we've reached out to patients that were lost to follow-up, and through the hard work of all the IPA representatives, we managed to re-engage a lot of patients. Furthermore, we are always looking at opportunities to expand the survey to countries, other countries, and include more patients. This continuous progress of re-engaging and including new patients leads to solid information which we need for the Pompe survey to study Pompe disease more and more precisely. Another project that we are working on is the new website. We heard that several participants had problems with the website, so we are in the process to make it more user-friendly and make it more easy for people to participate in the survey. We expect it to be finished at the end of this year or maybe early next year. Finally, we will continue to collect and analyze the data you all provide so generously to us. At this moment, we are busy with evaluating if ERT prolongs the time patients need to before they end up in a wheelchair or ventilator support. Furthermore, the long follow-up will enable us to evaluate the effects of ERT over longer periods of time. And finally, if a new therapy becomes available, we'll be able to compare it to ERT and also be able to compare it to the natural course. Finally, I would like to thank all the people involved in the research in Pompe disease. In this picture, you see almost the whole team from Rotterdam. Furthermore, I would like to thank all the IPARA representatives and everyone involved in patients' organizations for all their hard work and dedication. And most important, I would like to thank all of you, the patients, for all the questionnaires that you have filled out so loyally over the years. From this point, I would like to take some questions. If you have a question, if you are watching this afterwards, you have a question, feel free to send me an email so I can answer it for you. And again, my apologies for the way the slides bounced up and down. I really don't have a clue how that got in my presentation, so my apologies. Also, if you have any ideas on the website, how you think it would be more user-friendly or more accessible, I am also very, very happy to hear them.
Participants who have a question can submit their question by typing their message in the rectangular field and pressing Enter to send it. Those of you who are listening on the telephone, if you'd like to speak, you can press 7# on your phone now. There are no questions at this time.
Okay, well then I would like to thank everyone for their for their time and attention.
Thank you, Dr. von der Meiden. This concludes today's AMDA webinar. Thank you all for attending.